And that's why we're going to the water park. No, no, no.
So you can impress the ladies. With what? Your disregard for your own life?
Nuh-uh. So I can win their hearts with my ice slide technique. I don't want to die sad and lonely like you.
I don't think there's much chance of that, if you try and ride the Eviscerator.
No?
Of course not.
You'll die slowly and painfully, in front of hundreds of terrified bystanders.
You know, it's pessimism like that that's making your species extinct.
Okay, okay, but we've been looking for the water park for hours. I thought you knew where we were going.
No, I do. I kinda. Oh, hey, you see those signs? Well, if you stand by them and press the action button, you'll receive a hint on how to progress. Come on, let's go!
Yeah, I'll catch up. Eviscerator. Inspiring name. Thank you.
supposed to be?
He don't look like a possum. Well, look at that hair on his tail.
Should I get Ellie? I'm not sure about this guy.
Forget it, Crash. He's not worth it.
Hey, buddy! Stay away from my sister, or you'll have to deal with me.
I need to keep a careful eye on him. One wrong move and that's it. You're carried away for lunch.
You're an hors d'oeuvre, aren't you? You think Manny really is the last mammoth? Cave for some peace and quiet. If I find you following me in there, you're in for it. There's nuts in those caves, but don't be mistaken. Try to collect them, and I'll hear you. There's so many rustling bushes, I doubt you'll be able to sneak around without me hearing you.
Busy eating. You wouldn't believe how many of these I need to eat if I'm to keep my energy up. What happens if I don't eat enough? Well, I'd get so tired and hungry that I could hardly move.
Thank you. Hey, what's up with you? Are you stuck down there? Tell me now! Ah, I'd love to help you, but I've just had my shell waxed and it's nice and clean and shiny. There's no way I'm gonna risk scuffing my shell to help you out, you little girly mammal. Ow! Hey, watch it. Don't make me mad. Oh, you want to reach the high ledge by jumping off my back? Take a hike! Jeez! Ouch! That's it!
Oh! folks. Step right up. Gamble your winter food supply for the chance of winning something special at Fast Tony's Penguin Ball-O-Rama. Aha! Now you look like the gambling type. I know what you're thinking. I couldn't have anything you want, right? Well, what about this? Ooh. Awesome! Well, away you go. And good luck!
Practicing, right? Well, you're just plain lucky. Well, here's that nut. What? You thought you were getting a golden nut? You gotta be crazy. They're rare as gold nuts. But I doubt someone like you will ever get their hands on one of those.
Life was good in the water park. Everyone had something fun to do, even Sid. The main thing was we all felt safe in the valley. That is, until we heard of the flood that was supposed to come. We didn't believe the news at first, because who would believe Fast Tony without checking up on a story? Well, we didn't even get a chance at first to look into it, because Sid sort of interrupted our investigation with a wild stunt to get some attention.
Help. Check that one out.
Wow! Now that was impressive.
Couldn't have done it better myself.
You know, Sid, I think you've proven yourself.
Absolutely. You the man.
After we all survived Sid's little stunt, we found out Fast Tony's story was true. The ice was melting, and the glacier protecting our valley home was about to break apart. We went back to warn everyone, but it was still a tough story to sell. Luckily, the story was backed up by some of our feathered friends who were kind of looking forward to the impending disaster, as it meant they might have quite a feast. There was a way out, though. A large boat formed from a dead tree at the other end of the valley could carry us all to safety.
Thank you. Thank you. For breakfast. Now get going.
Thank you.
So hungry that I can't even move. The only food I can find is at the top of that tree. I'm too hungry. Ugh, to climb it. Feeling better, just need a little more. Was great. I feel like a new bear, or whatever I am.
Up telling you guys, I heard a mammoth. It's just that stinky old bear.
Manny, you're just gonna have to face the facts. Maybe you're the last mammoth.
All right, come on, let's go. If there are any more mammoths out there, I'm not gonna find them hanging around here.
Oh!
thing.
Come on.
Reach that final climb. Ooh, better get you back up there. Try not to fall again.
Really?
Thank you.
For shame, Diego. For shame. Are you really gonna let them get away with that?
I think he's gone soft.
Yeah, I think you're right. Oh, the Diego I used to know wouldn't stand for this. Oh, no. He'd be using their bones as toothpicks by now.
Hard to believe you let him get away with that again.
Yeah, I think you better give it another shot. Not after that last one. That was kind of weak. Proved your point.
I'd have hit him a bit harder. We met up with some of the other animals leaving the valley to escape the flood. Some were a bit stranger than others, including a female mammoth that thought she was a possum. We took her and her two possum brothers with us on our journey.
Thank you. Oh! Thank you.
My manners, but there's been some strange stuff happening around here. Eggs have been mixed up in their nests. And since you're here, you can help sort things out. Return all the eggs to their correct nests, and I'll help you leave. But not until then! Watch out for some of the mother birds. If they catch you carrying eggs around, I don't know what they might do.
Thank you. What? ice melting? There's so much more mud to play in. Mud is so cool. Come on, guys, let's play.
Hey there, Furball.
If you want to join in, come and talk to me. You need to pass the test before you can play. See if you can follow this pattern. Personally, I don't think anything as furry as you has the brains to outwit us.
Oh.
down there in the mud, you can ride on my back.
Oh!
Right? I bet you're after the swamp nuts. I hear they're really tasty, if you like that kind of thing. I know the swamp birds like them too. In fact, they stash some on their nesting platforms. I look there if I were you. Well, you can tell which ones they are. They're the ones with the tall bushes growing on them. But I don't think you'll be able to reach them. Perhaps the swamp birds could give you a hand?
Thank you.
Took a little rest after our trip through the mud bog. Sid put his one and only talent to good use and made us a little campfire. Of course, even this got him into trouble. And then he had quite an unbelievable tale to tell about what happened that night. Whatever it was, I'm sure it was pretty weird and kind of scary in that Sid kind of way.
Sacred fire dance. He could be the one. Ew.
You know, there are more festivities to prepare until that sacred beacon is lit. Whoa! Until an elder tells me otherwise, the sacred beacon is off limits. I'm sorry. Oh.
If you can beat me at digging, you can have my precious nut. Time to dig! Let's go nuts!
Okay. Hey, stranger. Please feel free to give an awesome offering to the Sacred Fire Totem. Check him out. Okay, just like toss the offering into his mouth and he'll be all like chomp chomp. Okay, different donations will affect different aspects of the totem, which is totally weird.
A storm scared all my Bojo birds last night. Now they are all hiding out of reach. If I don't have them all safe, I won't be able to go to the celebrations. If you could help me out, I will make it worth your while. They're quite timid, so just chase them back to their nests.
Thank you.
Ceremony goes for a nice hot fire soup. Achacha! I need 4 more chilies to really heat it up. Hey, you look like a foreign guest. If you could bring me the chilies, hey, I'll give you a gift with my thanks. Bada bing, bada boom, how you do?
Thanks to you, my birds are safe, and I can go to the celebrations. As promised, payment for all your hard work. A nice, shiny nut. My friend. I need 3 more chili. Thank you, my friend. Hey, look at that in there. I need 2 more chili. My friend. Just 1 more chili to go, and then we're gonna have a proper fire soup. You know what I'm talking about. Ah!
You, my friend. Wow, that's what I call a real fire suit. Hey, thanks for the help, buddy. Here's a juicy nut for your troubles.
Frere, we can't conclude the ceremony for the fire god until the beacon on the mountain is all like lit up and going woo-hoo. With your tail on fire, I'm sure you could totally ignite the fire water. Plus, you'd look awesome. You'd be all like, whoa! You know, I'm sure there's a tasty nut up there as well, Broham.
Thank you. Ha ha! Oh!
they're both stuck in here. That's just great. Well, if you quit hanging around, maybe we can help each other get out of here. Break those blocks with a stomp attack. That should be enough to lower me down.
There are four in total. You know, you can use the vents to shoot yourself across to the far side.
Oh, be careful. Be careful, though. Jump short, and you'll be shot into the bubbling lava. All right, just three more to go. That was well done, by the way. Another one? Well done! Ooh. You're something else, yeah. Two more to go, though. little guy. Come on, follow me and we'll get out of here.
The flood was starting to catch up with us. We woke up that morning in camp to find water everywhere. Sid seemed to have done some sleepwalking that night, but when he came back, we got moving as fast as we could. We got to the rescue boat, only to find a scene of complete chaos. Just getting to the boat was not the end of our struggle. The water in the valley was getting more and more violent and washed Ellie away, trapping her in a cave. I knew I had to do something, and do something quick.
What exactly are you? Listen, cats don't like being wet. I'm not scared of the water, I just don't like it. The only way out of here is over there, but the roots flooded. We need to find a way to drain all of this flood water. Thank you.
out of here! Ah! Thank you.
After a terrifying struggle and a race against time, something unforeseen but life-saving happened. The glacier cracked and the water in the valley drained out. And we're not sure how this happened, but we're not going to question a good thing. In the end, it all worked out. I found another mammoth, Diego got over his fear of water, and even Sid got a little respect. Just a little.
I always felt that Manny was the main character. He's got the deepest backstory, and, you know, before they do anything, Manny has to decide that's what's going to happen. But I've also always identified, obviously, with the Scrat. I mean, the Scrat's a character we made up because we needed something for the Ice Age to kind of pound on. You know, he's just the hapless, smallest character that kind of just has to deal with, you know, he's at the bottom of the proverbial, you know, pile, as they say. The Scrat never appeared in the screenplay for Ice Age. It was never written. The Ice Age starts kind of in the fall, and it becomes whiter and whiter as we go. It gets colder and colder. And so we thought, how might we personify the Ice Age? How might we make the Ice Age itself a character? And maybe, you know, it's a glacier, you know, Ice Age glaciers. Maybe it's a glacier that's chasing somebody. Okay, cool. Then let's see, who should it be? Well, it should be the smallest character we can think of. And our character designer, Peter DeSev, made this little tiny thing that was, I forget what it was called, there's a long Latin name for this tiny, tiny creature. And it looked like a little squirrel. So we thought, it should be him, it should be the smallest guy. Let's put some saber teeth on that squirrel and that'll be the guy. So we came up with a sequence where the glacier chases this poor little fellow, and it was one afternoon where we needed to make some sounds for it. So I went into the booth and I made some silly noises, and that's pretty much how I've made a living since. You know what? There are a few rules for Scrat. You know, nothing can come out that sound like words. And he always has to lose. He has to lose at the end of every cartoon. Basically, there's two rules for Scrat. He has to lose. And I kind of like that about him, you know? I like to, every once in a while, when I'm feeling kind of bad about myself, I like to pick someone in the news that's got things worse than I do. And it just, I don't know why, it just makes me feel a little better.
Coming back in here at the very bottom, and this will be take two.
You'll die slowly and painfully.
Working on Ice Age 2 was very, first of all, I knew the character, so that was fun. It was fun to get back as into Manny. I'm not saying Ice Age 1 wasn't fun, but Ice Age 2 was fun because of the new characters, and also I get a girlfriend. And anytime I can have a girlfriend in a movie, I like it, even if it is animation. Manny is such a mammoth, he's such a curmudgeon, and I had to find the soft moment, but also keep him, you know, you didn't want to make him too wimpy.
One truly is the loneliest number.
We were in the studio for a while there, you know, trying to find the moment where you saw his heart and all that, and I cried. Manny's the good guy, he's a curmudgeon, but he's got the heart of gold. I want to be a cartoon villain. Yeah. Who's funny, though, also. And he also gets a lot of women, cartoon women. My kids love video games, but they're in the movie. I had to give them a line in the movie. I had to make sure they had a line. So, and that'll be the ultimate, is if they could play the game while watching them. If they could be in the game, I think it would be years of therapy.
Ice Age is always fun to make, whether it's the sequel or the original. It's just Ray Romano's a very old friend of mine, as is John Leguizamo. So the idea that the three of us are interacting with each other in a giant animated situation is just cracks me up, because we all started around the same time. We all kind of knew each other when we had no money. We each do a lot of improv within the framework of what they have. So it's always interesting to come into a session and find out what John has improvised or Ray has improvised, and then I have to improv something back at them. I just did another improv thing today that they'll have to react to.
You better watch it. You're kind of like popcorn to a saber tooth.
I don't really identify with anybody. I laugh the hardest at John because that character is so funny. And I always picture him doing it. His face screwed up at the microphone.
making that voice happen. This is a three-hander. It's John, myself, and Ray. So it's finding the energy. You know, in this case, in Ice Age, the movie was really based on what John came up with as the voice for the sloth. And that's the comic centerpiece of the film. So then around that comes, you know, what Ray does and what I have to supply. In reality, it's always about John. It's always about Sid, and everything revolves around him. My character was pretty easy to come up with because I had to play the heavy in the first one, and even in this one, it's all about him annoying me. And I've been lucky because I've been a ladybug and, you know, a saber-toothed tiger. So, you know, it's not bad. It's not parts I would normally get cast in. We usually don't see the movie finalized till we sit down with, you know, John's kids, Ray's kids, my kids, the various nephews and nieces that come. So it's a high-pressure situation because if the kids don't laugh, and we haven't done our job.
The most fun of Ice Age 2 was they wrote me a lot of great jokes, and that was a lot of fun. And also, I think the sequence where the mini sloths worship me. I mean, I don't mind being worshipped. It's not I'm not a narcissist or an egomaniac, but it wasn't bad. Did this great call and response things with the mini sloths using tribal sounds and just silliness. And I did all kinds of like curly voices, like, woo, I sing it, and used that. It was really weird and avant-garde and kind of funny. The second one was a little different because now we really knew our characters. We really knew what we were going for. We found the tone and the comedy in it. And before that, it took a long time. It took a couple of years for us to figure out what we were doing and who we were and what we were after. This time it was just like zoom. It was just a matter more of really getting that story tight.
I'm quaking.
I love animation. I mean, Mel Blanc was my hero. So, I mean, I love cartoon voices, or as now they call it, animated voices. But yeah, I want to continue doing a lot of voices. You know, I try to come up with different things. You know, I got Sid, which is, you know, higher, sillier voice like this, you know, and then the high-pitched insanity. And try to do, you know, things with a, you know, much more superhero-type voice, that kind of stuff, going to a deeper, more powerful range. You know, older kind of voices, maybe. Maybe Scottish, I might try some voices. Little different types of accents, I might, you know, try it. I used to play back in the day, but you know, I don't have time for video games, unfortunately.
Can't talk, too busy eating.
I love doing voices. I would have to say the fructose intolerant bear is more fun than the dodos. They both have a lot of fun. The dodos were fun because they were so stupid.
I get so tired and hungry that I could hardly move.
I was nervous about doing Charlie because I hadn't seen anything and it hadn't been really explained to me. I was just sort of asked to come in and give it a shot. And Queen Latifah was there. And she gave me a big hug and said, "You'll be fine, baby." And that was really pretty much my preparation. It gave me the courage to go in and do Charlie. I play video games probably too much. It's amazing how good young people are at them. Somebody will kill you, and then you'll hear the voice through your TV, "Ha, I killed you, I killed you, you're dead." And at first I thought, wow, this little girl killed me. And then the second time this little girl killed me, I realized, "Ha, you're not dead. Wait a minute, that's a boy. He's got to be like 11, 10, 11 before the change." And it just, it's amazing to me. I love playing it. I love taking them on. I will always lose to 10 and 11-year-olds, but I like to try.
Oh, so hungry.
Working on Ice Age has just been an amazing pleasure, and I just feel so fortunate to be surrounded by not only this amazing cast, but these group of animators that have sort of revolutionized the way we watch movies. And I fell in love with the first movie when I saw it. So just knowing that I would get to be in Ice Age 2 was like, you know, it was a dream come true. Why not?
Where'd Ellie go?
My inspiration for Eddie was, I guess just a mix of Evel Knievel, because he's just a daredevil, and a little bit of Josh Peck, just a mix, and some paprika in there, just a little spice it up. Felt like Eddie needed a little extra taste.
We ain't going anywhere!
I'm 100% Eddie, absolutely. If you discount all the stunts, because I didn't learn how to ride a bike until about 3 months ago, and all the vibrato and all the machismo and the fact that he's a possum. Other than that, we're identical.
Mess with us and we'll disease you.
Eddie, it is sort of the epitome of Napoleon syndrome, I guess. So he's little, but he's a force to be reckoned with. Absolutely.
Of course Ellie's not a mammoth.
This Ice Age game is just gonna get kids just amazingly hooked into it and really love it. But go to sleep at night, you know, don't, you know, mess up your bedtimes or anything like that. We're all on the train, so all aboard.
Exactly.
Let's go.
Game over.